to Mr. Annamalai Jayaraj from Batliwala and Karani Securities India Private Limited. Thank you, and over to you, sir.
Thank you. Welcome to TVS Motors 2Q FY21 post-result conference call. Apologies for postponing the call by 1 hour. We have with us today from TVS Management, Mr. K. N. Radhakrishnan, Director and Chief Executive Officer, and Mr. K. Gopal Desikan, Chief Financial Officer. We'll start with Mr. K. N. Give a brief on the 2Q FY21 results and the outlook. Will be followed by a question and answer session. Over to you, sir.
Sir, apologies for the delay. Happy Dasara to all of you, all your family. I hope all of you are fine and safe. As far as TVS Motor Q2 results are concerned, despite challenges related to COVID, we strengthened our supply chain during September quarter. Production and sales improved consistently from July. July was 2.44 lakhs. It improved to 2.77 lakhs in the month of August, and September we further improved to 3.13. And we are hopeful that this month should be better than September. The total two-wheeler sales for the quarter was 8.34 lakhs, almost in line with last year's number. The September alone, if you look at it, we have grown by almost 4%, 4.2%. Exports is very strong, almost 7.8% growth over last year Q2. We have significantly done better than the industry. Three-wheeler production also started improving, and we have sold 33,000 numbers compared to last year's 43,000 numbers. Total revenue for this quarter is 4,616 crores, grown by 6% compared to 4,348 crores of last year's second quarter. Strong focus on the cost reduction initiative helped the company to improve the EBITDA for the quarter 9.3% compared to last year 8.8%. EBITDA in absolute terms increased to 430 crores from 382 crores. Growth of almost 13%. PBT before exceptional items for this quarter is 267 crores compared to last year's 234 crores. Second quarter last year, we had reported a one-time exceptional gain of 76 crores. Excellent working capital management resulted in substantial reduction in inventories, receivables. In addition to that, improved profitability resulted in a net cash flow of more than 1,000 crores. This is for the first half. With respect to PTTVS, I think we were able to, Q1 was a challenge, but Q2, we have started improving. We sold almost 14,698,000. Compared to last year's 13,934 numbers, registered a small growth of 5.5%. Three-wheelers also started doing now 1,253. With that, we have operating PBT of 0.04 million USD. Compared to last year, same quarter was 1.03 million US dollars loss. For the season, we have launched the TVSM NTORQ, TVS NTORQ 125 Super Squad Edition. This is inspired by the Marvel's Avengers. We are associated with Disney's India Consumer Product Business to introduce a special Super Squad Edition. Of course, this is India's first Bluetooth connected scooter with RTFI technology. This Super Squad Edition will comprise three new enticing offerings: Invincible Red and Stealth Black and Compact Blue. This is inspired by the Iron Man, Black Panther and Captain America. Another exciting color, glossy yellow and black, added in TVS NTORQ variant. Apache RTR 204V single channel ABS variant launched with Smart Connect and Glide Through technology. And I am very happy that during this quarter, Apache brand has crossed 4 million sales, and thanks to all the customers of Apache. Festive season, we have seen marginal growth over last year. We are seeing predominantly in premium products, and we are very sure that the agri growth being positive, reservoirs are full, sentiments are positive, urban markets are opening up, and we have seen urban markets retail reaching pre-COVID levels. So as we have said last time, we are cautiously optimistic about Diwali sales. And we have been putting enough effort in terms of supporting, and supply chain is also improving. Overall, second half, this positive sentiments in rural will help. And the series of relief measures announced by the union government will improve the liquidity. And that will be beneficial for medium to long term. And we are hopeful that government will consider and reduce the GST for two-wheelers from 28 to 18, which will definitely help the demand. Urban markets are now open. We are witnessing pre-COVID levels of consumer retail. The spread of COVID is also slowly coming down, and we are only sincerely hoping that the personal hygiene, social distancing, wearing of masks, I think, if we systematically are disciplined, I think it can definitely bring down the incidences, and death rates will come down. This is very, very important. As far as international market, we are witnessing very good growth, stable oil prices, availability of foreign currency, and stability of exchange rates are helping. In addition to the pent-up demand, many are preferring two-wheelers to avoid public transport and shared services. We continue to remain cautiously optimistic about the second half of the year for the domestic market, and export market is definitely going to do much better. And we will gain momentum. We have a very strong portfolio, mega brands like Apache, Jupiter, Ntorq, HLX, Radeon, TVS King. I think we are very positive that we will continue to grow, and we will the TVS CS is TVS Credit Services help. I think that is also definitely helping us to build these brands very strong. And we are confident that we will grow ahead of the industry, both in domestic and international. The cost reduction initiatives, what we have put in place 2 years back, have started yielding results, and the same focus will continue. With that focus, I'm pretty confident that going forward, we'll have robust improvement in EBITDA. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Shall we begin with the question and answer session?
Sure.
Thank you. We will now begin the question and answer session. Anyone who wishes to ask questions may press star and one on the touchtone telephone. If you wish to remove yourself from the question queue, you may press star and two. Participants are requested to use handsets while asking questions. Ladies and gentlemen, we will wait for a moment while the question queue assembles. The first question is from the line of Jinesh Gandhi from Motilal Oswal. Please go ahead.
Hi, sir. My question pertains to the retail trends. You indicated marginal growth during the festive season. So this would be, you're just referring to Navratras and Dashera, right?
This is a small growth, I think, compared to last year. So as you know, the Dashera season is one-fourth or one-third of the season. So we have to cautiously look at it, but we are optimistic. Given the kind of product range what we have, we are very optimistic. That caution is, again, we have to be very, very careful with respect to the COVID. So given the kind of stable start and also the opening up of the urban markets, I think we are cautiously optimistic about the season.
Okay, and you also indicated that this growth has been predominantly driven by premium products. So does it mean that rural market, in fact, declined during festive season?
I think rural market, the sentiments are positive. Even in the rural, these products like Ntorq, Jupiter, Apache is sold very well. And I say the Jupiter Classic version, Grande version, they are all available in rural market also. So the customer point of view, I think what we are seeing is a more higher pull in terms of products which are little bit more premium, which is expected primarily because of the money availability.
Right. Got it. And second question pertains to the cost-cutting efforts which we have done. So we have seen a substantial reduction in staff cost on YY basis as well as on the other expenses. So can you indicate how much of this is sustainable? Are there any one-offs over here? How should one budget for this?
No, it is not cost-cutting. It is cost-management. That is one clarification I would like to give. Because we have been focusing on material cost in a big way, okay, and that is definitely helping us. And with respect to marketing, we have gone along with this new normal significant proportion through digital, and that will sustain. With respect to the employee cost, we had a salary reduction which we have reinstated from 1st of October. So overall, I think the initiatives, whatever we have started in material cost or other costs like marketing and other areas will continue.
Okay. Understood. And lastly, a couple of data points on what is the inventory at the ground now at the dealer level? And secondly, our USD INR realization and export sales for the quarter?
So inventory, we are always careful because we always believe that around 30 days of inventory we try to keep. When the season times, it will go a little bit up. Again, it will come back to that level because that is sustainable. That we have been maintaining for a longer time. And that policy will continue.
Right. And export revenues and USD INR realization?
Exports revenue, just to give me a minute. Q2 revenue is about 1,123 crores.
Okay. And USD INR?
I didn't get your question.
Dollar realization.
I think it is about 74.5.
Okay. Thanks, sir. I'll come back in queue.
Thank you.
The next question is from the line of Pramod Kumar from Goldman Sachs. Please go ahead.
Sir, at the front, I think congratulations on a great set of numbers. We haven't seen companies expanding margins in this current environment. So on that point, I actually wanted to check if there are other anything which will kind of reverse out going forward in terms of benefits like, say, MEIS. And also now that you're talking about a salary getting reinstated, so what does things like MEIS benefit being capped at 2 crores and employee expenses going back higher and probably some of the commodity inflation, or what does all this do to your margin journey for the coming quarters, or and how do you plan to mitigate them if at all you're kind of looking at sustaining these margins levels? So in short, as of whether these margins are actually sustainable, and if yes, so what are the mitigation factors you have for the headwinds ahead, sir? Thank you.
See, the salary reduction was voluntary because of the certain uncertainty at that time. The moment we are able to see improvement with respect to the business, we have reinstated. That is not going to create any impact going forward. Number two, in terms of this export incentive, they are very small. Okay, we have very clear action plans, and I'm very sure that government is also planning to propose new schemes coming, which is likely to be from January onwards. There are discussions happening. So the remission of duties and taxes on export products, there is a scheme now government is planning. So MEAs, wherever the reduction is there are some price increases, some cost reduction. So overall, it is not going to anyway affect Q3 and Q4.
So in a way, in short, you are kind of hinting towards sustainability of these margins, subject to volumes, of course.
Absolutely. I think the initiative of continuous focus on cost reduction, cost management on all aspects will be further strengthened so that we are able to deliver very robust margins going forward.
Fair enough. So the second question is on the market side, both for domestic and international. On the domestic side, we've clearly seen, as per even Vahan database, that your YOR market share for the season, at least so far, seems to be trending up materially well. And you also refer to the fact that your inventory levels are not that high. So if you can throw some color on what exactly, and you did talk about a retail growth for the first 10 days of the season, which is encouraging given that most of the experts would put the industry at a decline. So if you can just help us understand what has actually worked for you on the ground, because I believe you are not one of the, you're one of the few who is not discounting in the marketplace as well. So what is working for you in this season on the market share side? And similarly, we have seen your export volumes have been kind of hitting new highs recently. So even there, if you can just broadly help us kind of gauge as to what could be the potential ramp up of volumes or the kind of growth what one can expect even on the international market side, like given the fact that your volume or your market share is still not that high in the export side of the business. If you can just help us understand these two parts.
The stock levels in the market, we always have a simple principle, keep 4 weeks, and during season time, maybe add 1 or 2 days extra. But 4 weeks, we have seen 30 days, 28 days to 30 days is sustainable for dealer point of view. And that we always look at. Second is that the first 10 days, we have seen a marginal positive growth, and we are hoping that the same trend will continue. That's why I keep on highlighting that we are cautiously optimistic, because urban markets, we have to see that it is all opened during the next 10 days, and Diwali season is a very important season. The sentiments in the rural are positive, okay? And definitely the product portfolio is definitely helping us, because the Ntorq and Apaches and Jupiter variants are definitely helping us. And I'm with the retail finance availability, I am cautiously optimistic once again in the domestic market. Export market, as far as we are concerned, I think we are seeing a very good pull. Again, it is primarily because of the pent-up demand. Again, the stability in the oil prices, oil, foreign currency availability, stability of exchange rates. So, and our product range, I think HLX is an excellent product range. Apache is a very good product range, and TVS. So overall, it's a combination of consumer sentiment, stability, and I think more and more the local people adhere to the COVID discipline. I think we will see markets becoming better and better going forward. Only thing is, we expect in the domestic market, if some more support in terms of the GST reduction, that will also aid this revival of the demand.
Sir, on the export side, is it given the ramp up you have and the kind of outperformance what you've had in the last several quarters, right? Is it fair to assume that it can be a double digit growth opportunity on the next few next few years in terms of compounding a double digit volume growth for the next few years? Is it kind of achievable, assuming the macro environment doesn't deteriorate definitely? As in that, given that assumption, is it fair to assume a double digit CAGR over the next 3-4 years?
Our sincere effort is make the customer be delighted with our products. That is exactly our focus. So we will continue to do that and come up with models which are customer liking, and then focus on working with the distributor in the international market, work with them very closely at the ground level. That is the simple strategy what we use. I think that is what is giving us results also. So I'm confident. I don't want to put a number on the growth rates, because a lot of uncertainties. So the optimism still continues, because please understand there are many other challenges because of the COVID and other issues we are seeing. So we have to be very mindful about that. Okay. And the product range what we have is liked by the consumers very well. So and slowly and stably we are able to see the supply chain able to support us in terms of ramping up the numbers. Still there are challenges, but we are getting over it. I would put it that way.
That's the final question, if I may, on the new launch pipeline, because we understand that you have some white spaces in the 125cc commuter scooter, 125cc commuter motorcycle, and you also showcase the cruiser. So if you can just broadly share, when will we have these launches coming to the market? Because these are substantially large addressable markets, which we are not present. And it could be definitely a tailwind for the market share going forward. So if you can just comment if COVID has kind of really pushed out the launches, or you still plan to make these launches in the near to medium term.
See, as a responsible company, we have a strong R&D. We have been always investing in product development. And we have been always looking at the white spaces. That journey will continue. I may not be exactly able to guide you when we will come up, but I can tell you that none of the projects are delayed. I think we have learned a lot of new normal way of working. Okay, so I think closer to launch, I will be able to share more information on which are the white spaces, what is it we are planning to do.
Thanks a lot, sir, and wish you all the best. Thanks, Dan.
Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Shyam Sundar Sriram from Sundaram Mutual Fund. Please go ahead.
Hi, sir. Good evening. Thanks for taking my question, sir. Sir, firstly, from a demand perspective, you seem to indicate that the urban markets are doing better than rural for us. Is that what you're trying to communicate, sir? And going forward, also we.
I did not say urban is doing better or rural is doing better. I am saying overall, we are able to see pent-up demand, whatever we couldn't see in Q1. Second, more and more we are seeing urban markets are opening up, thanks to now opening up in many areas. And wherever we have opened up dealerships, we are able to see the pre-COVID levels of activity and consumers walking. So I think this year, the monsoon has been normal, agri is growing. These are all positive sentiments. So overall, we are seeing positive sentiments and more urban markets opening up. I think that is also going to help. Second, because of public transport, many people want to look at, cell-phoning. So they are looking at two-wheelers. That is also going to help. Okay, so that is why I said we have to be, we are very cautiously optimistic about Diwali. Okay, at this point of time, because wherever we are seeing the opening of dealerships, we are seeing the customers intending to buy. That is a very healthy sign, given where we were in Q1.
Understood, sir. And from a scooter portfolio, that is one part of a portfolio which has been quite slow. And given that, schools, colleges are yet to open up, this urban markets opening up as we look into Diwali, what are your initial feelers, sir? Is there more pickup seen in scooters, due to the need for personal mobility? Is that some trends that we are witnessing on an improving trajectory?
Urban markets opening up will definitely help a little bit more scooter. We have been having some challenges in the ramp-up. The demand for N-Torque and all, very good, but there has been some challenges in the supply chain, again, due to COVID. We are correcting it, correcting in the sense that the COVID situation is also improving now. I think the new normal, everybody is learning to understand how to manage. So while the urban markets are opening, we are also seeing better pull, and also the supply chain situations are improving for us.
Understood, sir. Understood. One question from a cost perspective. Our raw material cost on a per vehicle basis has increased more than the ASP increase, if you see on a year-on-year basis. Is this more due to higher moped mix in our portfolio? If you can just help us understand this part slightly better.
See, raw material, last year to this year, when you compare, this year everything is BS6. Okay. The geography mix, product mix, there is also a little bit of impact on that. But overall, the cost reduction initiatives have helped us significantly. Okay. And going forward, there will be some increases in the raw material because whether it is steel or aluminium, there are some increases we are all expecting. Okay, so that might affect, but we are confident because of the combination of cost reduction and some price increases, whatever we have taken, And overall, as a company, the kind of new normal, the way we have taken in marketing or in all other areas in terms of digital or overall cost reduction initiative, I think we are pretty confident. It's a combination of both the range, mix, and also international market plus the cost reduction initiative. I am saying we will have a robust growth in our EBITDA.
Understood, sir. And just on the commodity prices that you mentioned, sir, so given, aluminium prices have anyway seen a very strong increase, and I presume we would have completed our half-yearly negotiations as well. So given all this, are we seeing a little bit of, is there any impact on our gross margin going into the second half of the year?
No, these are, see, when the demand goes up, definitely these are the costs which will go up. I think it is a combination of initiatives, whatever we have taken in terms of cost reduction, price increases, and the product mix, healthy product mix, and international business. That's why I said a combination of all these actions will continue. That will help us to improve significantly the EBITDA to go.
Okay, understood, sir.
You have seen this quarter, for example, we are at 9.3 compared to 8.8 of last year. This year, 100% of our sales is coming from BS6.
Correct. Absolutely, sir. On the export side, on the three-wheeler exports particularly, sir, month on month, we are seeing an improvement therein. So going into second half, can we now start crossing the last year levels and go into a growth trajectory? Is that basis or order booking? Is that something that we are seeing, sir? Hello.
This is the operator. Members of the management, we can't hear you. We seem to have lost the line of the management. Participants, please stay connected while we reconnect the line for the management. We have the line for the management reconnected. Over to you, sir.
Yeah. I couldn't hear you, the last question.
Yes, sir. Of the exports, from a three-wheeler export perspective, month-on-month, we are seeing a good improvement per se. So from an end market perspective, as we go into the second half, are we seeing the three-wheeler export volumes crossing the last year levels and going well into the into a growth trajectory? Two-wheeler, we're already seeing that pickup, like you had alluded earlier in the last call also, sir. Similarly, on the three-wheeler side as well, are we seeing that kind of momentum building up in the end markets?
Yes, two-wheeler, we saw very fast recovery. I think three-wheelers have started slowly and steadily improving month after month. Again, we may not be able to put a number by when it will be better than last year, but we are very happy that it is improving month after month.
Okay, understood, sir. One question on our capex. First half, we have done around 208 crores of capital expenditure from the cash flow. If you can indicate broadly, where are we spending in terms of the capex? Is it more on the new products per se? And on the depreciation side, we have seen a jump there. So is this correlated to the capex spends that we are doing? And how much capex are expecting for FY21?
I think we have we are improving the estimating a capex increase because some of the new products and export business and some areas in the export business we may have to invest in capacity. So we are planning to increase it to 500 crores this year. Okay. The other expenditure has been on various new products, tools, dies, BS6 changeover. I think that is what we have spent in the last two quarters.
Okay, understood, sir. Sir, one last question from a financing perspective, in terms of financing penetration, how has it been in the second quarter compared to the FY20 level? So we generally hear the financing penetration is slightly lower this year compared to last year. From our perspective, how has it been and what is the contribution of previous credit in terms of our overall financing pipeline?
You are right, slightly lower for us also in terms of the financial overall This again, it is around 46% this quarter.
Yes.
So it is around 46%, and TVS share continues to be around 50%.
TVS CS share
share is about 50%, and the overall penetration is slightly lower.
Going forward,
according to me, this will improve.
Thank you. Before we take the next question, we'd like to inform participants that in order that the management is able to address questions from all participants in the conference, please limit your questions to two per participant. Should you have a follow-up question, we request you to rejoin the queue. The next question is from the line of Amyn Pirani from CLSA. Please go ahead.
Hi, thanks for the opportunity. So actually, first I wanted a clarification. Does this quarter results already take into account the lower or the reduction in MEIS, or that will happen from next quarter?
Yeah, we have taken the reduction, whatever is applicable, in the month of September.
Okay, so there is no incremental negative impact in 3Q versus 2Q because of MEIS.
Yeah.
Okay. And so just, you know, on your other expenses, you know, apart from marketing costs, are there any other cost line items where you have been able to, manage costs? Are there any examples, you know, that you can give us? And also on the marketing side, is it possible that as we go into second half and, you know, as volumes, start to move up for the industry and even for you, you might have to start spending more?
Okay, could you repeat what you're saying?
Sadly, on the marketing cost, you know, as we go into second half, you know, and as volumes improve for you as well as the industry, is it likely that you will have to start spending more on the marketing side?
No. See, marketing, it is not an expenditure. According to me, marketing is an investment. Okay? It is building brand. Okay? Today, Apache, we are celebrating 4 million thanks to all those customers. So, we have to invest behind marketing. Entorq, today we are doing well thanks to the kind of investments we have made behind the brand. So marketing is an investment. Okay, I don't treat it as an expense, number one, because that investment only helps to improve the brand and later it translates into higher, more and more customers looking at the product, awareness creation, considering it and buying it. The critical change is more and more digital, you will see. Okay. And more customers we will be looking at online. So these are all in line with what is the new normal. Okay. And I think this is where we have to be prepared as a company, and we are already ready in that area. And we don't participate in any tactical thing. So you give good products to the customer, good retail finance, and create enough awareness of the product. That will help.
Okay. Thank you, sir. And so you mentioned that you are increasing your CapEx outlook to 500 crores. Apart from CapEx, in terms of investments into subsidiaries and, you know, probably some investments required for Norton, can you give us a ballpark number as to how much you will be spending on an overall in investment?
Investment, I think TVS CS will be another 50 crores, basically.
Yeah, to your current services will be 50 crores. And Norton, we will be investing around 40 crores, mainly to for certain capex for being planned. So no other current investments are contemplated.
Okay. Thank you, sir. I'll come back in the queue.
Thank you. The next question is from Pratik Poddar from Nippon India Mutual Fund. Please go ahead.
Yeah, hi, sir. Sir, I just wanted to check when you say that, you know, these are the new normals, post-COVID, you have adopted new normal practices. How sustainable is it even when a vaccine is finally developed and launched? Would you be able to build on those practices and not reverse to the old practices? Is that a fair understanding?
I think it's a very fair understanding, because each of Each of this pandemic, I think we are also learning certain things which are new. For example, before this, if you had asked me about work from home, I think all of us would have had a different way of thinking, saying that work from home is applicable only for IT companies. But we are able to see that our own design team, our own development teams are able to work from home. We have shift A, shift B, shift C. We are able to see that this is working out very well. So any good practices which are going to improve the effectiveness and overall reduce the cost, I think as a responsible company, we will also adapt. Okay, it is not the question of pandemic. Same way, now we are also able to see that online, many things are happening digital. I think if you look at India, our mindsets are always, we are a young country. We want to be looking at premium products. We want to look at like Apache or Entor. That is our aspiration. And such customers, they are already coming through online, even before pandemic. So this is going to make some new learnings and new normal that exactly whatever is applicable, we will definitely use it. And it is sustainable. Definitely it is sustainable.
No, sir, if I may just extend this, and I'm just clarifying this, if you were to go back to FY19 levels, when the industry peaked, the margins for us, or say this, we would build on these other expenses, right? It's not that these other expenses would be lost, but we would build on this, and profitability versus on a like-to-like basis, say if we were to reach again FY19 levels, the margins would be substantially higher, maybe possibly double-digit, though I'm not trying to put words in your mouth. But they would substantially be higher than what they were even in this quarter, right?
I look at it, first we have to delight the customer so that we grow the revenue faster than industry, number one. Number two, towards that you have to invest behind marketing, invest behind brands, invest behind new products. That is our job. Number three, if you look at all the costs, we have to keep looking at what are the innovative ways of reducing the material cost or any other cost. Okay, two types of benefits will come. One, scale benefits will come. Second, you have to keep reducing weight of the product, alternate processes, alternate material. These are all consistent journey. Okay, then you come up and build a huge big brands, like Apache or Entorg or Jupiter or HLX. Build a scale. Okay, then automatically it will have its own benefit across the supply chain. So like that, we would like to do many of the aspects, whatever we have learned. First, we focus on customer. Second, we focused on the growing the market share. Now we are focusing along with that in the last 2 years on the EBITDA journey. And I'm very confident that if you systematically put a process behind that, I think it will improve quarter after quarter. That is exactly what we have seen even in this quarter.
Fantastic, sir. This is very reassuring to hear. Sir, last, just wanted to check, this MEIS reversal, has it been done for the first 6 months? Like, there have been a lot of competitors who have done the reversal for the first 6 months. Have we done the same, or it's only for 1 month?
See, again, I always respect competitors, okay? We have done it from 1st of September.
Got it. Thank you, sir. I'll fall back in the chat.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Gunjan Priyatni from JP Morgan. Please go ahead.
Yeah, hi, sir. Thanks for taking my questions. I just had two clarification on some of the comments you made earlier. Firstly, on the inventory side, you mentioned that 28 to 30 days is normal. What is the current inventory level in the market? If you can just give a sense on that. I'm not sure if I missed that part. And secondly, if you were to talk about the recovery across sub-segments within your own portfolio, how would you rate as mopeds, bikes, scooters? How would you, rate the recovery across different sub-segments versus pre-COVID or versus last year levels, whatever is comfortable with you?
The inventory 30 days is a ballpark number. It can go between 28 to 32 depending upon market to market, because there are Dasara markets, there are Diwali markets. Okay. Broadly, if you keep this kind of an inventory, ultimately this inventory is made to make sure that there is no retail loss. The customer walks in and say there is no material available, the vehicle is not available, it's a big loss. So if somebody wants Apache, somebody wants Entorse, they will come back. Okay, if it's a commuter motorcycle or a normal scooter, they might even go to competition and buy. So that is that we have learned through our very good system, saying that 28 to 32 days, 33 days is a very good time. And we are maintaining that, okay, because there is always this flexibility. And also this helps the dealers also very well, okay. Now, coming back to what we need to look at is we need to have a portfolio of products so that overall we look at, okay. There may be always some models doing very well, some models not so well. So it's a journey. And even in India is a, each state is a different market, I can tell you. There are markets where we do Jupiter better than Entorse. There are markets where we do Entorse much better than Jupiter. There are markets where we do Apache 164V better than 162V. So I think we have to play depending upon the market. Same way colors. If you look at certain markets want only red colors, certain markets want only black colors. Okay, I think we have to cater to the customer needs and provide products so that we balance it out.
Okay. And just one more question, just going back to the margins. If I really look at the gross margins, they have moved up. Now, I'm just trying to get sense how they should pan out for the remainder of the year when we look forward. There are clearly some RM headwinds we are facing. Now, if I think, you know, if you can just give some perspective on, you know, more from gross margin perspective. I mean, I appreciate the comments that you made on the fixed cost savings and other expenses, but some color on this would also help.
See, I think first of all, we have to look at last year to this year, we have completely moved proactively to BS6. Second, I think we have put the best-in-class technology ETFI, RTFI. Okay, then there are export products. So it's a combination of products, technology, and the geography and the pricing what we do. Overall, we have internal targets on portfolio-wise, but I always look at the overall portfolio, how is it performing. And overlay with that, cost reduction. Okay, that we are moving in the right direction, given the challenges, whatever we have seen in Q1. I think Q2, substantially we were able to improve. And going forward, I think with the demand cautiously optimistic, I think things will be doing. Overall margin will also do better. Okay. So I may not be able to give you segment-wise targets and how we are working on it. Overall strategy, material cost reduction, look at the product mix, look at the geography mix, and we will keep investing behind the brands to make it bigger and bigger.
Okay, got it. Thank you so much.
Thank you. The next question is from Ronak Sarda from Systematics. Please go ahead.
Yeah, hi, sir. Thanks for the opportunity. So first question, if you can just highlight, you know, what kind of price increase we have taken in Q2 and if any in October?
I think Q2 we took, just give me a minute, about 1.5%.
Okay.
And around 1%, I think the first week of October.
Sure. Okay. And the other part was, you know, I mean, if we look at the competition, you know, in the scooters segment has not picked up yet. But how are you seeing the inquiry levels and the footfalls, especially in the festive season? Are we seeing, you know, I mean, the way scooters had done, let's say, till FY19, are we seeing those kind of, you know, inquiries or footfalls coming back? Or do you still think there's some time away and we might see the real scooter, the latent demand coming back only in FY22?
See, the most of the urban markets are now open, and whatever we are seeing is pre-COVID levels of activities and customers, the prospects walking in, we are able to see.
Okay.
If the same discipline, whatever I said, you know, wearing masks, social hygiene, and the personal hygiene, and, I think if the people can be much more conscious about the safety, I think there won't be any need for again closing down. Otherwise, population being higher, the density being higher, the urban markets are always susceptible, you know. Suddenly we cannot have celebrations like the olden days because COVID is around.
Right.
So wherever it is open, we are seeing customers looking at it. It's and we are also seeing some of the consumers saying that they want not to use public transport. They want to look at a two-wheeler. That also we are able to see.
Okay.
And definitely more and more urban markets being, open, it will definitely help scooters going forward. And as far as TVS is concerned, we had some challenges in scooters ramp up, again, because of the COVID. And we are seeing improvements with respect to many of our suppliers helping us.
Okay. Sure. And on exports also, you highlighted there is some pent-up demand, and which is obvious given how the Q1 had planned. So when do we see, the normal run rate coming back for the exports? I mean, do you think Q3 will be a pretty strong quarter, and then from Q4 onwards, will go back to the usual run rate? Or is there some kind of, supply chain disruption in exports as well, where we have been able to, capitalize on some of the competitors, not only Indian competitors, but some global competitors as well. How should we look at the overall exports ramp up?
Exports, I think it is picking up well, and we are seeing robust growth in exports, and we have a very strong product pipeline, so that is going to help. I think oil prices are stable, currency availability is also much better. Currencies are also stable. So overall, I think most of the countries are opening up. There also, I would put the cautious optimism because COVID is still around. It's not that we have to be respecting COVID. Again, the basic discipline of wearing masks, personal hygiene, social distancing, everything need to be strictly adhered to. I think that is going to be around for some time. So I think it is a very, very good recovery, I would say, both for the international market and for us, TVS.
Sure, sir. Perfect. Thank you and all the best, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Venugopal Gare from Bernstein. Please go ahead.
Hi. Thanks a lot for the opportunity. I don't know whether this has been answered before, but I just want to check, is there a way to quantify within motorcycles how different is premium versus entry level in terms of growth rates this festive season? The reason I'm asking this is we're getting a fairly mixed commentary. One of your competitors mentioned premium is up 30% for them, but entry level is down 30%. So, so how are things for you?
I always respect my competitors because they are very strong, they are very good, they have very good products. As far as I am concerned, I look at the direction. In terms of the direction, I think premium, it makes also consumer sense because those people who can afford, they are coming first forward. That doesn't mean that the bottom of the pyramid doesn't have ability to buy. They will also come because now only markets are opening up, slowly employment levels are coming, they are also earning some money. I think it's a question of time. We have to give little time for all the people. And what is most important is the COVID situation. The numbers should keep coming down. The death rate should come down. The recovery rate should go up. For that, the discipline is very important. So it's all related, interrelated. Okay. So premium, India is a young country, aspirational country. So people want only to buy. I've always seen anybody who walks into our showroom, he may be a customer who is looking at, entry-level sport or a moped, but first he will go to Apache and he will come back. That is the aspiration. But unfortunately, he doesn't have money. So what he settles down. And same way, I have seen always people look at Ntorq. And they may buy, let's say, a Scooty or entry-level Jupiter. So this is something we should always respect. Initially, you will see pull in the premium, and that we are able to see. And more urban, again, you will see premium products will have pull. Okay, but it will slowly and steadily cascade. And if there is some more impetus from the government, that's why I keep on highlighting the GST. If there is some support which is going to come, that will also accelerate Okay, it's a combination of very strong discipline from all our members in terms of managing COVID levels, controlling that, and on the other side, all the enablers to improve, and retail finance. Okay, and fortunately, you know, we have a very, very strong product pipeline, and we have two excellent technologies, ETFI and RTFI, excellent fuel efficiency, very good attractive quality. So, and investment behind brand, you know, it's a combination of all these things that is what is generating the cautious optimism.
So, you know, thanks for this, but just as a follow-up, you mentioned that, look, the government helps, of course, if GST gets cut 10% or, you know, there's an advantage. But at the same time, given the things in the economy, especially when somebody's not sure of his employment or job, especially, you know, in certain segments that you mentioned, given that, you know, you would be getting some commentary on the ground from retail walk-ins, you think that price sensitivity or a reduction in price is a more important variable, which could actually help drive demand in this sort of an environment as compared to a usual environment where a price could probably could bring in more demand? So employment versus price cut, is it material? Does it really help much?
See, the two-wheelers, according to me, two-wheelers is a very, very important aspect of Indian auto industry, especially for mobility. Because thanks to the investment behind infrastructure, today the mobility needs are there, okay? And mobility is not only commuting alone, it is also self-employed. There is a significant proportion of customers who are self-employed. So if they are able to, you know, buy a two-wheeler, they are able to do much faster things and they earn a small income out of that. So this is also supporting employment in a different way. So I am saying, we have to be looking at that bottom of the pyramid and see what all things we can do to enable them to earn money. Okay, this is very, very important. And in that, I'm saying the GST revision, it's a 10% is a significant proportion with retail finance. Somebody can own a bike. It is going to help them for revival. So it's all interrelated. It is all interrelated. All the points where you put it, one is so for example, COVID. COVID levels are coming down. More dealerships are open. More dealerships are open. Definitely, we are able to see more walk-ins. People are able to buy. People are existing customers are able to come for service. They are able to travel more. They are able to do activity more. It's all correlated.
Sure. No, sir. Thanks a lot for the answer. Thanks.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Hitesh Bhargava from BNK Securities. Please go ahead.
Thanks for giving me the opportunity. I have a couple of questions, sir. First question, like one of your competitors has said that they have gained market share in few of the geographies they operate. So did we also gain some market share in export geographies?
Overall, if you look at our number, I can tell you so far, the exports industry has grown by almost minus 40%. We are at minus 29%. Okay, I am talking about April to September. So we always look at, can we do better than the industry growth? And that keep trying. It's not going to be easy because you have to look at the retail, customer retail. You have to look at stock levels. You have to look at the lead time for reaching the pipeline. So I think it's a combination of everything. So our simple task is, as much as possible, you know, keep growing faster than the industry, because industry has got many other factors. Okay, Q1 we saw many challenges. Q2 challenges are a little different. So we have to look at strong brands and keep investing behind the brands, connect with the customer, and work along with the distributor, dealer, to generate more and more walk-ins. That has been our focus.
Sir, actually, I was referring in export markets in any of the countries.
I'm only talking about, I gave you answer only related to exports. The industry declined by 40% in the first half, April to September. We have declined by 29%.
Okay, sir. And you have, for someone's question previously, you have referred that MEIS impact is already visible. So can you quantify what was the impact of MEIS in 2Q? And did we pass on this in the export market?
No, no. MEIS, I told you these are certain things which will be always be there in the market. We have seen in the past also. So whatever the decision of the government, we have also adhered to that in the first week of September. So there is we have considered that for the September month. And going forward, we are very confident that new scheme, which is likely to come from 1st of January, there is already representation. So we are hopeful that it will come. Meanwhile, whatever is the net impact, we are also looking at price increases, cost reduction, a combination. Product mix, it's a combination. We look at.
Okay. Can you quantify what was the impact in last quarter?
Last quarter, September, it is very, very small. Very small.
Okay, sir. Thank you. That's it from me, sir.
Can we have the last question, please?
Sure. We'll be able to take one last question. We take the last question from the line of Vasudev Banerjee from Ambit. Please go ahead.
Yeah, thanks for taking the question. Just a couple of things to understand. First of all, congrats on a great set of results. If I remember last year, Credit Services delivered earnings of almost 155 crores. So what has been the health of its business in the first half, if you can say, because I can see around 55 odd crore investment in Credit Services. And in the call also you said further 50 odd crore in the second half. So where it is already profitable significantly, so why further investments going out?
Not very clear the question.
Yeah,
can you please tell me?
TVS CS first half for quarter performance and how is it going? I can share it. I think the TVS CS book size as on 30th September is 9,920 crores. Net worth of the company is 1,399 crores. The PBT for Q2 is about 14.3 crores. We have provided about 25 crores in this, correct, Desigan?
Yeah, we have provided 25 crores of provision on this.
Okay, and it is doing extremely well. Liquidity is not an issue for the company. And going forward, I think they will do very well.
Surely. So basically, that's a type of
capital.
Yeah.
Why am I coming to this question? Because this quarter, if I see your consolidated earnings is lower than standalone earnings by 10 odd crore. So typically, Credit Services has been giving a good cushion to the losses of Indonesia. So something must have happened this time. So I think this 25 crore provision gives the answer. And the part of the initial question only, sir, why this continued investment in the Credit Services, like 100 crore investment in this fiscal 21, where still it is self-sufficient as far as, so anything on that angle?
It is very profitable. This business is definitely profitable and it has been giving a steady profit. This quarter, there is a provision of 25 crores. This again, you are able to hear?
Yes. Yeah. 25 crores provision in line with the restructuring related provisions. After that, I mean, just to give a few more things, the collections are comparable or better than the pre-COVID level. That's number one. Number two is the capital infusion that is happening is to maintain the capital adequacy ratio, which is though the RBI says 15%, we are afraid ahead of that. we maintain a 17% capital adequacy ratio. Therefore, this investment from TVS Motor is required. And the business what we have done in Q2 is around 2,300 crores when compared to 1,800 crores in the comparable previous quarter. Again, as already informed, the penetration for the two-wheeler industry for TVS Motor is 46% retail finance, and 50% is catered by TVS Credit Services.
Sure. So one thing just wanted to understand, as I'm not an NBFC expert, when this capital adequacy ratio-led funding requirement will come to a halt, if one can understand, sir?
We'll come back here on that. The company is doing extremely well, and they are a very important enabler for TVS Motor, and it is very well-run, profitable.
It is also growing steadily. And book size is also growing. Steady. Yeah, it is growing steadily.
And the last thing, sir, any comment on health of Indonesia business in this quarter?
Indonesia, PBT break-even, we have made a small PBT this quarter, but going forward, the demand is very good. Q1 was not representative this one. This quarter, for example, Q2, we have done almost 14,698 two-wheelers compared to 13,934. A growth of almost 6%, and three-wheelers also we have sold about 1,253. Overall, we have made a small PBT of 0.04 million. Going forward, we will make better volume as well as PBT.
So that's very encouraging, sir, as compared to 42 crore loss in FY20. So already you are at PBT profit, leaving aside Q1. So
absolutely.
You can assume, leaving aside Q1, that 40 crore loss might also go away, turning into profitability.
Absolutely.
That's great. Okay, sir. Thanks. That's all for myself.
So,
thank you.
Thank you very much. And thanks for joining. Sincere apologies for the delay. So, like I said, we are cautiously optimistic thanks to the kind of portfolio what we have, both in domestic as well as in international. I think overall Q2 has been very good. We are seeing good initiatives of cost reduction definitely giving us the benefits. Excellent working capital management also helped us in substantial reduction in inventories and receivables, and that has helped the net cash flow in H1. And going forward, this cautious optimism is, and the good product range what we have, will help us grow ahead of the industry. Cost reduction initiatives, whatever we have put in place, will help us to also steadily grow our EBITDA. Thanks to everyone. Happy Diwali. Stay safe and hope for complete recovery of COVID soon because of our discipline. God bless and thank you.
Thank you very much. On behalf of Batliwala and Karani Securities, that concludes this conference. Thank you for joining us, ladies and gentlemen. You may now disconnect your lines.